morning from Poplar Grove, Illinois. I'm here at Poplar Grove Airmotive, and today we're going to walk through the engine overhaul shop where Steve Thomas and his crew overhaul over 200 engines per year. Poplar Grove started by Steve and his dad back in the 70s and really expanded in the 1990s when they started a residential aviation community here on the field, and today have the engine shop, flight school, budding avionics division, and of course the residential community. And over there, which I'll show you later on, a museum and also an EAA chapter that has built a Jenny, which is a World War I era biplane, using the blueprints from scratch. Let's go inside.
This is our airframe shop where we do annuals and repairs on everybody's airplane, engine removals and reinstallations. You know, there's always a few airplanes here that people fly in and have us do the removal, the overhaul, then the reinstallation. The challenge is finding a place to park them for the downtime, you know, because we always want to keep a customer's airplane inside with the weather in this part of the country. Now, these are engines waiting to get worked on. They come in from all over the country, and this is kind of our holding pen. Once an engine arrives, we receive it. We open a work order book with all the serial numbers and all the data and the marching orders, what the engine's here for, repair, prop strike, or overhaul. And it all starts here. And then as we chew through this, this holding pen, they go into the shop and we start working on them. They might be here these days a couple, 3 weeks before we can get them in the shop.
How many engines in the queue these days?
I believe there's 120 engines, give or take, in the shop now, including these.
Okay.
So it's...
Every time we speak, it goes up.
It has been. And there's more coming. I know there's three or four engines en route right now. Now, this is the engine shop, and these carts have someone's engine. Each engine is assigned a cart. So, and when they're not being worked on, we cover them with plastic so they don't accumulate any dust or foreign material. This is your engine, Dave. And this is your book. And we got your name and address, all the particulars of your engine, and our marching orders to prepare engine for reported cam and lifter failure, stop and report at inspection. Okay. So at that point, we're gonna stop and tell you what we found, and then we make our decisions then on what you'd like to deal with. Because at that point, we can still repair it, or we'll know what we've got for issues, and then we can continue on with just some simple repairs, and boy, you have a good engine for long haul. Or if there's some serious issues, maybe you elect to overhaul it while it's in, and then you're good for a long time.
Okay. This stuff here, corrosion like that, can that typically be?
Yep, that's not bad.
Okay.
That can be cleaned up.
And on the motor mounts.
Yep, I noticed up here, we talked about that.
What is that?
Once we get her clean, we'll know if there's any pitting or damage done. But it's hard to tell right here. But it's an indicator, and that's why we take lots of pictures. Before we even put a wrench on it, we take pictures of everything so we can refer back to it.
Okay.
We'll be starting on your engine shortly. Everything gets clean. Your engine looks kind of nasty right now. But by tomorrow afternoon, everything will be down to the bare metal and clean. All these parts will be cleaned so we can inspect them. The crankcase will be dye penetrant tested, all the aluminum castings, like he's washing off a crankcase right now. And then we'll check that for cracks. It's a non-destructive way of testing for cracks that you can't see with a naked eye.
Yeah.
All the steel gets cleaned and it'll go to for magnafluxing, which is the non-destructive way of testing steel for cracks that you can't see. Now we'll make our way to the cylinder shop. This is our cylinder shop, and you can see we got lots of cylinders. And brand new cylinder kits in the boxes, as well as cylinders have been removed for either repair or overhaul. Depends on what the customer wanted. In your case, your cylinders will come here for inspection, just like the rest of it. Well, these are cylinders for each job in the shop. It could be related to an engine on a cart, or it could be where shops just send us individual cylinders. They have low compression at an annual, and hey, can I send you the cylinder to be repaired, whether it's refacing the valves and the seats or replacing guides or just re-ringing, you know, putting new rings, pistons in. Now we get into the inspection and rework area. Brian, are you reworking an engine or inspecting?
Reworking. We're reworking this. I just checked in parts for this. I didn't want the girls and parts to get too crazy when the parts shelf gets too big.
Yeah, yeah.
There's too many parts.
Relieve it. It's going to end up here anyway.
Right. Yep. I get them out of their way.
But this is where Brian, when he's inspecting, he starts out and he's looking at every tooth on every gear, measuring and rebushing all the pieces that go in the engine
to make sure they meet the tolerances required.
Yes. Okay. And when they get to rework, they'll put new bushings in the rocker arms, and they check the face on the rocker arm. You know, this is real important to have perfectly true, because if it's worn at a slight angle, when it's moving that valve up and down, it could be putting a side load on the valve, and then it'll wear the guide, the valve guide.
I see.
So it's really important to have this perfectly true. I mean, there's lots of little things that the folks do through this inspection process. This is more of the same. Here, those are working on different engines. Yep. And then we work our way around to assembly. This looks like a 360 Continental for someone. And as we're building the engine, we have pictures that we took earlier when the engine came in to make sure we route the ignition harnesses the same way, fittings that go on the back of the engine, we have them pointed the right way, so when they go to install it, everything lines up the way it should. If we didn't have these, we wouldn't know, was this fitting go this direction or this direction? And we want to make it is give them the same thing back that they got. So their mechanic installing it isn't fighting something.
Now this is almost finished, right? Or it looks
like it is
at least.
Probably by the end of the day, we got to get mags and some other things on it.
Looks factory new, it's beautiful.
Yeah, it will be when it's done.
All the technicians are A&Ps? Or most?
You don't have to be. We're a repair station, so the repair station, the shop, signs it off. Some are, probably half are, some are, have inspection authorization. But a lot of times we can find some of our best technicians that aren't aviation oriented, but they're good with a calipers and a wrench, and they just have good judgment. Good mechanical aptitude's really important to start with.
How many folks do you have working for you?
I think there are about 60 total employees. I think 25 in this shop, in the engine shop, 2 in the accessory shop, and 7 in the airframe shop. Okay. And then, of course, the all-important ladies in the parts room,
right.
The 4 ladies in the parts room that keep them all happy. Even though we sell parts over the counter, probably 95% of their customers go to our mechanics.
Okay.
That's the biggest customer we have, is our own customers that are getting work done on their airplanes. Here's an early 470 out of a very early Debonair, and the customer wanted it custom painted. So we honored his wishes and had his own paint colors of his choice put on it, which we did. It's kind of fun. It's an emotional thing for a lot of people. You know, it's not just a piece of business. It's part of the family. Aviation is a emotional thing. You know, we love this. So from here, it'll go to the test stand. And we have two different ways of testing engines. This is our dyno. We build it ourselves. We fabricated everything on this ourselves. I bought a M&W dyno from a farm implement dealer that went out of business, and they used it for testing tractors, farm tractors. So we just modified it to serve this purpose, and it works great. We've tested hundreds of engines here. We designed it ourselves. Everybody had a fun part of MacGyver and how we're gonna, you know, engineer this
right.
thing. But it works great. We bolt this to the prop shaft flange, and this is the PTO shaft from the dyno hooks on here. So this, the engine drives the dyno.
Okay.
And then we increase a load against the dyno to measure the horsepower.
Yeah.
But the testing is quite a step regime. Lower power settings, shut down, check certain things. Higher power settings, longer periods of time. And then the last half hour, once everything's proven up good, we put preservative oil in it. Because we don't know how long it might sit at the other end before it gets reinstalled. So we don't want any corrosion to take place with everything fresh.
Right.
So that'll protect it a little bit. This is kind of what your engine will look like. This is an L2A 160 or 180 horse for a newer 172. It has new Superior cylinders on it because we couldn't get Lycoming. That's what yours will look like.
So whether it's an IRAN or an overhaul, it comes out
it'll
looking.
It'll come out just like that. Yep. Now this is an 0300 Continental for a Cessna 172. Earlier 172, it's 145 horsepower. If you find little things here and there, you can tidy them up so it's 100% when it leaves here. This is a six-cylinder Lycoming out of an Harman rocket. This is a big Continental that's going a turbocharged Continental 520 that's just leaving in the next, it's ready to ship. And I think we've got another four-cylinder Lycoming here, an E2D. This is an engine a customer ordered at a flight school in the Chicago area, and he's just not quite ready for it. He needs another week to, well, maybe I'll get these guys going on your engine.
Okay. Huh?
What'll it take to get it down to where you're splitting the case? 3 or 4 hours?
A couple hours?
Yeah. A couple hours, and then we'll split it, and then you can see what's inside. And I think once we get this disassembled, we'll have Brian from the cylinder shop inspect the cylinders, and you can be a part of that.
Okay.
And he can speak to you about what he finds.
In part two of this video, we'll watch a time lapse of the engine teardown and join Brian as he does a preliminary inspection on the engine. That's going to do it for part one. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to the channel. Also consider sharing it on your social media platforms for the benefit of other pilots and owners. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in part two.